good people don't smoke marijuana.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
The medical marijuana. The medical marijuana.
The medical marijuana. Whoa, 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 yeah. The medical, it's the medical marijuana show. You knew we know.
I wanna talk to you.
Everybody, welcome to another edition of Medical Marijuana Radio. This one is for Saturday, the 31st of March, 2018. I'm your host, Larry Love. We're here every week to bring you the latest information on medical and recreational use of cannabis, and we cover everything from all over the globe. And we'll go around the states today. It is Easter and Passover this weekend. It was difficult to get a guest to interview, but I did find some very interesting clips from all around the states and Canada, and also a TED talk by Dr. Jeff Chen. A UCLA researcher that I found pretty interesting, and we'll play two clips from that later after we do some news. But first up, as always, I've got news for you.
One, two, three.
Yes, and this first one is from Forbes magazine, Forbes.com, and this is just from a couple days ago. Low THC medical marijuana programs, a bust for the cannabis industry. And this is written by Mike Adams, and he's a contributor to Forbes.com. Although medical marijuana is legal in over half the United States, not all these programs are created equal. Some are comprehensive, giving patients with a laundry list of qualified conditions the freedom to access various strains of marijuana with a recommendation from a licensed physician. Others are more restrictive. These typically only give patients with specific debilitating conditions, like certain types of epilepsy, the freedom to treat their symptoms with a legal form of cannabis. The toe-in-the-water approach to medical marijuana forces participants to rely almost exclusively on expensive, low-THC cannabis products. It also requires them to jump through a series of hoops, approval from more than one doctor, etc., before they can even begin to think about visiting a dispensary. These factors alone prevent many qualified patients from leaning on legal sources. Instead, they continue frequenting the black market, where they can get their hands on the real medicine they need. Despite all the problems surrounding low-THC medical marijuana programs, cannabis companies scramble like wild-eyed fiends to get in on the action whenever a state approves a program of this kind. But many of them have learned the restrictive nature of these programs does not come with the promise of a golden goose at the end of the day. Louisiana is set to launch its medical marijuana program in the coming months. The law was designed to give patients with around 10 serious conditions access to low THC cannabis products. Because the state has no smoking rule, no raw flower can be sold. But now the companies approved to service Louisiana patients are starting to panic because they say the current business model does not provide them with an opportunity to turn a profit. There simply isn't a strong enough customer base for any of them to operate in the black. So this is going on in a lot of places, especially down in the South. So it's something that has to be done, because they really aren't doing their patients any favors, giving them dumbed down medicine. And in some cases where it's just CBD, where you need THC with it, they're not getting that at all. You know, testing of medicine is very important. We've talked about that, you know, over the years. This is from Cannabis Business Times. Steep Hill, Alaska is suspending operations after Wells Fargo calls in a loan. Steep Hill, Alaska will suspend testing operations on March 31st. The owner of Steep Hill's Anchorage office building lost its loan from Wells Fargo on the grounds that the property is housing a cannabis business, an approved cannabis business. The landlord's loan came up for renewal, and during the process, someone in the corporate Wells Fargo sent a letter down saying that they wouldn't renew the loan with a cannabis business in the building. CEO Brian Coyle tells Cannabis Business Times. Coyle says the business has been in the building for 2 years since AK Green Labs first acquired the license deal with Steep Hill, the low-slung building in the quiet side of the street with houses houses for other tenants. Wells Fargo just was adamant, Coyle says, describing something of a negotiation process that had been unfolding since December. This is very typical, and Wells Fargo has done this before. I can remember even here in New Mexico, Wells Fargo would take a dispensary on for a while and then dump them all of a sudden, causing all kinds of problems. But again, that's something that needs to be worked out. Now, here's some news clips we're going to run over to now. I don't know how this is going to help the medical cannabis industry, but Mitch McConnell all of a sudden wants hemp removed from the controlled substance list. Really interesting. Here it is. I don't know. This is not about medical. This is about hemp. But yet hemp is about medical as well, isn't it?
We all are so optimistic that industrial hemp can become sometime in the future what burley tobacco was in Kentucky's past. So I will be introducing, when I go back to the Senate a week from Monday, a bipartisan bill in the Senate to continue to support this important Kentucky industry. It'll be the Hemp Farm Act of 2018. What will it do? First and foremost, this bill will finally legalize hemp as an agricultural commodity and remove it from the list of controlled substances. I believe hemp has a bright future in our state. It's fine. It's now time to take the final step and make this a legal crop for every state that wants to file a plan with the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And if they file that plan with the U.S. Department of Agriculture, the regulatory mechanism comes from the federal government down to the state. So the way that would work here is that Commissioner Quarles and his team would have the regulatory oversight of this way forward, and the federal government would simply step aside. For any state that did not file a plan, the federal government would still be preeminent. But for those who are in the processing field, it would legalize the interstate transportation of hemp through a state that might not have taken the step of filing with USDA and therefore having the regulatory authority come down to the state. So that's the goal.
So that's the goal, but you know, what's the fallout going to be? Legalizing it, hemp, is that legalizing CBD? Is CBD still going to be on the Schedule 1 list? Look, this is up in the air. We have to watch how they write this thing. Because these guys, they sneak stuff in. Who knows what McConnell has up his sleeve? But is this a step forward? I don't know. I think we need to have some more discussion on that. But at the same time, because Attorney General Sessions has been so against us, we have him to deal with as well. So Marijuana-friendly states want a meeting with Sessions to talk to him about how to move forward in our legal states, states' rights. Remember, folks? Here's this.
And Mark, Lori, this is another move by the Trump administration to roll back or rescind an Obama-era policy. As you noted, it's way too early to know how this will all play out, but it's a move that potentially targets states like Washington, where pot is legal.
The politics of pot has left states divided, with only six so far that have legalized marijuana for both recreational and medical use. Most of them are blue West Coast states, including Washington, and most recently, California, the Golden State's future pot economy valued in the billions of dollars. 21 other states have approved marijuana for medicinal use, and two others, plus D.C., have legalized both uses, poised to begin sales soon. It's an issue long been opposed by Attorney General Jeff Sessions.
This drug is dangerous. You cannot play with it. It's not funny. It's not something to laugh about. And trying to send that message with clarity that good people don't smoke marijuana.
That was then Alabama Senator Sessions in 2016. Today, the now AG issued this memo to U.S. attorneys nationwide, rescinding an Obama-era policy that discouraged federal prosecutors from going after marijuana-related crimes in states that have legalized the drug. Sessions cited a return to the rule of law to disrupt criminal organizations and tackle a growing drug crisis. His memo also emphasized leaving discretion up to individual U.S. attorneys.
And this announcement is obviously an attempt to throw everything up in the air and to frustrate the will of the voters of this state and several others.
ACLU attorney Allison Holcomb, one of the authors of Washington's 2012 initiative to legalize marijuana, says it's too early to know how or whether federal enforcement could change in this state or beyond. But today's move could potentially serve to chill a budding industry.
It has an impact on people who are trying to open businesses and now fear that they may be at risk of being federally indicted. It may have an impact on whether or not banks and credit unions will continue to work with these new organizations.
Western Washington's U.S. Attorney Annette Hayes, in a statement today, stressed her office's enforcement efforts will continue to focus on those that pose the greatest safety risk. But there's no doubt new confusion over the potential implications nationwide and an apparent flip-flop by the president based on what he told our sister station in Denver as a candidate in 2016 when asked if his AG pick might try to shut down legalized marijuana.
No, I think it's up to the states, yeah. I'm a states person. I think it should be up to the states, absolutely.
Now tonight, there's also some question by Democratic lawmakers, namely New York Senator Kristen Gillibrand, about why DOJ resources would be diverted to potentially cracking down on marijuana instead of focusing on the opioid crisis, a stated priority by the Trump administration. On the other side of this debate, Washington Republican Congressman Dave Reichert supports today's move by the AG, saying it merely directs U.S. attorneys to follow their well-established principles in pursuing cases. He also said it's an important opportunity to pause and reflect on the use of marijuana and the effect it has on youth.
Of course, we can't trust anything that comes out of the administration that's currently running and ruining our lives. So, you know, you got to take everything with a grain of salt and watch how things roll out. Everybody wants to be in the cannabis industry. This is one of the highest, quickest growth businesses that we've seen since the beginning of the dot-com era. And so, you know, everybody wants to invest in the cannabis industry, whether they know anything about it or not. Everyone wants to work in the cannabis industry because they've smoked a joint. But there's a problem going on right now. And in Nevada, which has an extremely busy recreational and medical market, Nevada Marijuana Dispensary says it's hard to find qualified and serious people to work. So I'll play this and then I'll add a couple of my own opinions here.
Nevada's new recreational marijuana industry has faced its fair share of challenges, and now some dispensaries say they're having trouble finding enough qualified employees. The problem is not interest. Open positions get hundreds of applications. The director of the Sierra Cannabis Coalition says it's more about finding competent workers who take the industry seriously.
They feel like because it's marijuana based, it'll have a laid back atmosphere, you know, a very loose and fun place to work, when really we're actually the most regulated business in Nevada. So there's a reality shock between, hey, marijuana's fun and cool, and what it takes to work here, follow the laws, follow the regulations to the right degree.
Keep in mind, applicants must be 21 years old and have a squeaky clean record with no felonies and no drug charges on your record in the last 10 years.
10 years, he said. Anyway, so look, here's the problem. You know, I worked and managed a dispensary here in New Mexico for 2 years. And, you know, I was in my early 60s at the time. I never got high at work. I was responsible for all kinds of stuff. I had a lot of experience in retail and in smoking this plant, you know, and being around this plant and growing it for 50 years. So there's a work ethic that needs to be involved here. In 2 years, I never missed a day of work for being sick, yet the 20-year-olds would call in when their noses were sniffling. So how do you hire somebody? Who is qualified to work in a dispensary? You know, as far as it is right now, especially in this state of New Mexico and most of the other states, it's a medical state, so you need to have some training. So there are these pop-up training schools, so to speak, and a lot of them are very, very expensive. So you need to ask certain questions and get answers to, you know, what are you getting for your hundreds of dollars for these classes? Is it just a printed out certificate that anybody can print out on their computer? You need to find out who's qualified. Are these people qualified to teach you and to issue some kind of a certificate? What is their background? Just because you go and take a class somewhere else, does that make you now a teacher? I don't think so. So I think you need to be careful. You think you need to ask questions. You need to ask these organizations, you know, how many jobs they've gotten for people, because you're spending your hard-earned money. I know you want to be in this industry. Again, everybody does. So read everything you can. Train yourself. Be knowledgeable. There's studies out there that you can read and learn from. I've been in this industry, you know, in the cannabis industry, including, you know, working at the dispensary, you know, for 10 years almost now. And I've been doing this radio show. This is our ninth year. I learn something every day. So it's important if you want to be in this industry, you know, if you got a lot of money, and you just want to get in because, you know, you want to make money, but you know nothing about cannabis. Well, you know what? Go into people, you know, partners with people that have really great credentials. I know people in this industry. They've been around for 8 and 9 years. They still can't grow good medicine. And I'm looking at, you know, what's happening in this state right here. And I hear about the same kind of stuff in other states as well. Educate yourself. And if you are a money person, hook yourself up with people that know what they're talking about. Anyway, that's my two cents today. In California, where it is legal to have medical and recreational, there's still some cities and counties that are against it. Oceanside, California is considering regulating medical cannabis, but you listen to these people, some of them that still aren't getting it, the reefer madness is still there in parts of the state. So here's Oceanside, California.
I feel that teens at our school are really susceptible to falling into the trap of drugs, not just marijuana, but any kind.
It is time we stop pretending we can make cannabis use illegal. 2020.
Residents in Oceanside sound off as the city council considers regulating medical marijuana. Good evening and thanks for joining us tonight. I'm Barbara Lee Edwards.
I'm Carlo Cicchetto. Oceanside city council members considered ordinances that would allow the cultivation, manufacture, and sale of medical marijuana.
Dozens of people on both sides of the debate packed the council chambers to make their voices heard. CBS News 8's Abby Alford has more on tonight's outcome.
The Oceanside City Council approved medical marijuana cultivation, say those farms. But here's the catch. They rejected any type of dispensary. And the police chief says it'll take them at least a year to forward an analysis to have the impact of what these dispensaries could do in their community. While recreational marijuana is legal in California, North County communities, including Oceanside, are still debating whether to regulate medical marijuana.
These are people who are not getting high, who are not robbing or raping people. They're just taking this medicine because they don't want to take narcotics.
Oceanside High School students took their concerns to the city council Wednesday night, who considered regulating medical pot.
Having medical marijuana dispensaries in Oceanside will remind teens that it's out there, and it will make them think that it's healthy, that it's accessible.
And then you have the marijuana supporters, but they don't like the proposals limiting cultivation, the 1,000-foot rule, and restrictions on the number of dispensaries in industrial areas.
We feel allowing for only 2 dispensaries is just feeding into the reefer madness we have fought so hard to overcome.
Others fear allowing medical marijuana will impact property values and public safety costs.
So why would you allow more problematic businesses with their all cash, pungent marijuana smell, large amounts of water use, robbery, armed guards? It goes on and on.
But medical marijuana patients say it's about safe access.
The North County Transit System doesn't even reach the first available dispensary.
There are plenty of other drugs that they can get a prescription for at a hospital, so marijuana is not the only thing that can suppress their pain.
And an hours-long discussion and a lot of back and forth,
thing.
The Oceanside City Council approved cultivation of medical marijuana, but they rejected any dispensaries.
Here's the timeline. The medical marijuana proposal will go back to the city council on April 11th for second reading. If it is approved, it'll then go into effect 30 days after that. But council members say it could take anywhere from 12 to 18 months to get all that licensing and be operational.
And some of these cities and counties, they want to, you know, get revenue from the taxes and so forth. Some very misinformed people there. That one young lady who is very young, she's a young teenager, she's just being misinformed and just not taught what the plant really is. You know, it is the safest way to get rid of your pain. Moving up the coast to Berkeley, California, you know, there's a big problem with the black market. You know, they legalize cannabis and they hope that the black market you know, goes away, but you know it's not going to go away because of the way they've written some of these bills. The taxes are just absolutely over the top and causing people to go to the black market. So Berkeley, who's been way ahead of the world practically in almost everything over the last 50, 60, 70 years, Berkeley figured out, well, let's cut the taxes to compete with the black market. There's other things that can be done as well.
Tax break today for pot users in Berkeley. The city just dropped its taxes on marijuana from 10% to 5%. It's one of the only cities in the state to make that aggressive move. KPIX 5 Susie Steimel says the main reason for the drop is to fight a booming black market.
It's no secret the buzz surrounding January's recreational cannabis sales is fading. So too is consumer willingness to pay the higher taxes that came along with legalization. That's why Berkeley dropped its city tax today from 10% to 5%.
I think the sticker shock has been the biggest issue for all of us, really.
Sabrina Fendrick of Berkeley Patients Group, a long-standing dispensary in the East Bay, says dispensaries cannot compete with black market pricing. She worries this legal business that took years to establish could now be at risk.
Everybody wants to generate revenue. We all want to help serve our communities, but if everybody's going to the illicit market, then nobody's generating revenue and nobody's being helped.
With Berkeley's tax reduction, East Bay buyers now pay 30% in taxes at the counter. Cannabis taxes vary statewide from roughly 30% to as high as 45% in some cities. As of January, consumers have to pay a state excise tax, a cultivation tax, sales tax, and a city tax.
The taxes are kind of, I think, what's driving a lot of people to not come to the club anymore. I know a lot of my friends who used to come to the clubs are actually now just going back to the black market.
This black market is by no means hard to find. 2 clicks on Craigslist and you can buy an eighth for nearly $20 less than at the dispensary.
People are going, you know, to their old dealers to buy weed because it's cheaper.
There is a bill in the state assembly that would drop the state excise tax from 15% down to 11%. Berkeley leaders are hoping the tax reduction here will bring in more legal business and that other cities will follow suit. In Berkeley, Susie Steimel, KPIX 5.
So everybody needs to watch and learn and not get into this kind of mess. Don't be greedy, states and municipalities and counties. And, you know, just tax it fairly. You're going to make a lot of money. Be fair to the consumer, and there will be no more black market. Unless the black market can grow better stuff than the dispensaries. That's always something else to worry. How about licensing some of the people in the black market? Anyway, moving over to New Jersey, we're going to move around to some other states. New Jersey is expanding and making cannabis now available for chronic pain and anxiety and some other afflictions. But this is the governor. Listen to how he wants to change things. This is really great to hear someone like this be such a proponent.
The system we have inherited can best be described as medical marijuana in name only, more than in reality. With a hostile administration tugging the strings of state bureaucracy, the ability of dispensaries to open has been slow-footed. Doctors have faced stigmatization for participating, and non-smokable and edible products that could benefit patients have been blocked from the market. Politics, quite simply, politics replace compassionate care. New Jerseyans whose lives could be improved through the state's medical marijuana program deserve better access. Parents deserve the ability to do what they and their doctors agree is right for their children. The countless many other New Jerseyans who suffer from serious illnesses currently left off the list of approved conditions eligible for medical marijuana deserve access. PTSD not that long ago was not on that list, and Leo and others know that all too well. And doctors, by the way, deserve the ability to prescribe marijuana to their patients, again, free of stigmatization. In a minute or two, I will sign an executive order directing the New Jersey Department of Health and the Board of Medical Examiners to review all aspects of our existing medical marijuana program with a specific focus on expanding patient access. Further, and this is important because time is of the essence, and unfortunately the clock has run out with a blessed Jake, but for others, I'm ordering this review not only conclude within 60 days, but that it also end with proposed new rules and regulations, or if need be, the elimination, rather, of existing ones. We got Jake the Tank right there. Our goal must be to have a program that is modernized, is compassionate, that puts the needs of the patients first, and respects the decisions of doctors and the medical community. And we just cannot turn a deaf ear to our veterans, to the families of children facing terminal illness or other illnesses, or frankly, to any of the other countless New Jerseyans who only wish to be treated like people and not like criminals. I am proud to sign this order today for Leo, in Jake's memory, and for the many more New Jerseyans like them, many of whom are with us today. It is past time they be given the compassion that has been delayed for 8 long years.
Now that's a governor that cares. That's just an amazing announcement, and this guy really cares about the program. And let's see what happens about his promise to legalize for recreational use as well. But you know what? Fix the medical first. Why not? Patients first, then let's move on to the rec and make sure we protect those medical programs. Moving on across the country to Utah, you would think that Utah would be one of the last states, but it says here it looks like medical marijuana will be on the ballot in Utah in November.
Yeah, the number of signatures for that ballot initiative petition are quite frankly stunning. So is the numbers coming out of a new poll on how many Utahns support medical cannabis.
We've turned in over 160,000 signatures. We've had about an 80% validation rate with the Lieutenant Governor's office.
Well, as you can see,
the Utah Patients Coalition says it's had nearly 120,000 petition signatures verified across Utah. That's well above the 113,000 needed to get the medical marijuana ballot initiative before voters in November. The deadline for signatures is mid-April.
This is indeed going to be on the ballot for November 2018.
Medical cannabis is also polling like it's going to pass. UtahPolicy.com released a poll today showing 77% of Utahns favor medical marijuana. Asked about those numbers, even the governor acknowledged the issue's popularity.
I don't know what's going to happen. I do believe that people support marijuana use for medicinal purposes. And I'd support it too. I just want to have science behind it, making sure we understand that it does do something good. It's not just an anecdotal story.
You say you'd support it too, so if it makes it on the ballot, would you vote for it?
Well, I'm going to have to, if you got to read the initiative, it's not just do you support it, marijuana for medicinal purposes. There's other things, the devil's in the details, as we say.
Critics of the ballot initiative say it still asks too much.
When I poll my constituents, they want medical cannabis, but what they want is a very carefully controlled program, not the wide-open program that the initiative's sponsoring.
Representative Brad Doss sponsored bills to give terminally ill patients a right to try medical marijuana. He says the ballot initiative allows for smoking marijuana, has lax prescription and dispensing rules. He says the legislature is taking small steps to ensure they don't jump into what's essentially recreational cannabis.
We're taking it a step at a time, whereas the initiative takes a step not only to medical, but way beyond it.
Now, Representative Doss says that if his right to try law is successful, they would be morally obligated to spread this or to expand this in future legislative sessions. Now, the Utah Patients Coalition says that the legislature has had its chance and it's time for the people to have their say. Now, just a few minutes ago, I asked the Lieutenant Governor's office about the signatures for the medical marijuana ballot initiative. They say that right now they are still validating it. 26 of the 29 Senate districts is what they need to get, and right now the Utah Patients Coalition says that it's still working to firm up those numbers, particularly in some of the rural Utah areas. Live on the Hill, Ben Winslow, Fox 13 News, Utah.
Well, let's hope that they work out a good program, because a lot of Utah residents, I'm sure, are driving over to Nevada and getting medicine since they can't get it where they are. So let's keep people safe and give them real medicine and safe access to that. South Carolina is a step closer to becoming the latest state to allow for cannabis, and here is this report.
Kathy Stevens' daughter, who suffers from a rare genetic disorder, uses hemp oil to control her seizures.
She was having 5 to 7 seizures per month. As soon as we started cannabis, within the next month, that went down to approximately 1 seizure a month.
That was before the release of a new study published this week in the New England Journal of Medicine that found cannabis oil, or CBD, can reduce seizures by 40%, proving what Stevens has been telling state lawmakers.
When you have a publication that's that reputable putting this out, it's going to help our cause so much, because it really should be another medical option. It should be a tool in the doctor's tool bag that they have available to them.
Two medical marijuana bills advanced in the legislature this year, but did not receive a floor vote. The South Carolina Compassionate Care Act will be picked up again next year. Stevens says as her daughter gets older, she'll need stronger doses than hemp oil can provide.
We've got to come on board because people are suffering.
She hopes this latest study will bring relief.
And, let's hope, the article I just read a little while ago about the low THC states, and then there's, no THC states with CBD only. These states in the South, they're coming around slowly, but they do have to realize that these programs that they put a governor on, so to speak, and hold back, no pun intended, but maybe it was, they have to embrace the science. There's over 70 years worth of science coming out of other countries. I talk about it every week, Israel just for one. And from what I understand, what I've heard, the United States has funded to the tune of millions, maybe hundreds of millions of dollars, Professor Raphael Meshulam and the studies of Israel over all these years. So that needs to come out, because that's being really hypocritical, as well as, U.S. Patent 6630507. Anyway, we all know about that. Going down the East Coast, here is what's happening in Tennessee. The House Committee approves advances in medical cannabis.
This is 2018. It's time to move on. People are sick. People are dying.
Andrea Hauser traveled from Lawrenceburg to describe life with epilepsy. She's in favor of medical cannabis.
People's lives are at stake. I had three grand mal seizures one time, and they were so bad that I did not wake up for 2 days, literally.
Hauser could not share her story with lawmakers Wednesday. The medical cannabis bill hearing had 15 minutes before running out of time. The bill's sponsor, Representative Jeremy Faison, fuming.
The little girl Josie that you saw me sit beside, she's getting lost in the battle because law enforcement's so consumed with their little stupid thing to be able to go and arrest people for a simple possession, and then they have civil asset forfeiture and they put their stinking money in their pocket. That's all they care about.
State health officials did have time, telling lawmakers there isn't enough evidence to support the benefits.
Our guys from the Tennessee Department of Health up there saying it doesn't help Parkinson. My God, you got to be a special kind of stupid to not realize this helps Parkinson.
It was disappointing for those who drove hours to see lawmakers finally vote on an issue that's been controversial and lengthy.
I know I don't appear to be sick, but I can't drive. I didn't drive here today. I can't work. I can't drive to my kids' ball games. I mean, I'm so limited to do any everyday thing. It's like a domino effect.
Well, let's hope that these people can get their medicine in Tennessee and every state. You know, it really needs to be legalized. Everyone should have safe access. And a lot of us that do have safe access, we can't be complacent about helping people in other states. While we have safe access, there still are states that have programs that are still getting raided and busted. And this is because some of the rules are a little bit ridiculous, and some of them, you know, people just are not adhering to. So this is out of Fox News in Denver. Police raid a International Church of Cannabis. So raids are still happening, and there's raids in other places as well that we'll play in a minute.
As you know, marijuana is legal in Denver, Colorado. You may remember we had on a man who founded a cannabis church in the Mile High City. Police raided his church. The pot pastor is claiming religious persecution now, and a Denver judge just declared a mistrial. Joining me now to clear things up, pot pastor himself from the International Church of Cannabis, Steve Burke. All right, Steve, you look like a deity with the church in the background.
This is our church. I'm sitting in the chapel.
Are you hot?
Let's remember that this interviewer is from Fox News, so he's got an attitude already. He's just about to ask the head of the church if he's high.
High right now?
I'm not right now, but I plan to be later.
I don't even believe that. So, fill me in on the legal battle. You have a pot church. You believe in cannabis as a god, and the Denver police are cracking down.
So first thing I need to correct you on is we don't believe that cannabis is God. We believe that cannabis is a sacrament that helps one elevate themselves to a better version of self. That's why we call it elevationism. And we don't claim that we created this new religion, but people have been using cannabis as a spiritual sacrament dating back to ancient China several thousand years ago. So cannabis for spiritual and religious purposes is actually older than the United States of America.
So are you a Rastafarian? Is that accurate?
I'm an elevationist, the reason why we're sitting here talking today is because the city of Denver had two undercover cops infiltrate a private spiritual celebration on 420 of last year. We had about 300 invited guests, and two out of 11 attempted undercover cops, two were able to sneak or lie or manipulate their way in, and the city of Denver is now claiming that because these two cops out of 300 invited guests were able to get into a private ceremony, to the public, and anybody could have just walked in.
You guys were so baked, you didn't even see the cops slip in there.
You know, we were having our celebration. We had security at the front. A couple of these are trained operatives.
Yeah.
And they were to finagle their way in. I ask you the question, Jesse, if you have a private wedding and you have 300 guests and two people sneak into your wedding, does that make the wedding open to the public, or does that make those two people wedding crashers?
Yeah, no, they're cannabis crashers. So they declared this mistrial, and now you're in legal limbo. Are you still having elevationist ceremonies at the church?
Yeah, we have nothing to hide here. We celebrate every single Friday evening. We have our church services just like any other church. We have a different guest speaker and a different band that plays
each
week.
Can I just interrupt for a second? What is a cannabis church service look like?
So at our church, we have a different speaker and a different musical guest every week. We've had anywhere from tech CEOs to scientists, researchers, music professors.
Who's the musical guest? Snoop?
Snoop is more than welcome to come here if you'd like to be a musical guest at our church, and we would welcome him, of course. But, you know, this is no laughing matter, Jesse. The city of Denver is selectively prosecuting us and not any of their own properties where they allow people to smoke open and publicly, like Red Rocks Amphitheater, like Capitol Hill on 420 every year. It seems that they have a problem with our religion, and that's a problem for the city of Denver because we may end up going after them for civil law in a civil lawsuit.
All right. Well, we're going to be following the story, and good luck with everything out there in your legal battle, and enjoy the rest of the weekend, Steve. Thank you very much.
Boy, that Fox guy was pretty snide, wasn't he? Anyway, you know, cannabis is... been used as a sacrament religiously for a couple thousand years, that's all. So there's a bit of a history with that. But that was just another example of some teenage Fox reporter, so to speak, trying to be funny, and it really wasn't. But anyway, again, still, in Michigan, they've had a medical program that has been almost without rules all these years, and lots of dispensaries have... just blown up there, and they've been fighting trying to regulate it for a long time. So Michigan ordered more than 200 medical marijuana businesses to shut down. And this is going on while in a legal state.
Michigan regulators are ordering hundreds of medical marijuana dispensaries all across the state to shut down, including some here in West Michigan. State leaders say the 210 businesses all failed to apply for their state licenses by mid-February deadline. Michigan Department of Licensing and Regulatory Affairs released the total number of stores today, 2 weeks after it began issuing cease and desist letters. More than 150 of those shops are in Detroit, but some, like we said, they're in the Muskegon, Battle Creek, Allegan, Berry County areas. Michigan is in the process of licensing marijuana businesses under a law that took effect in 2016.
I need to find a really good reporter, so to speak, that can update us on Michigan, because it's been a fight there for so many years. They need to get it under control so that people can have good access. Again, it's all about safe access, and law enforcement still seems to be in the way. Moving above Michigan, across the border to Canada, Canada, which is had a program going. They've got huge companies buying out each other in the medical industry. Legalization is supposed to happen. They're still raiding people. Here's the latest raid, and then we'll take a little break and come back with Dr. Jeff Chen from a TED Talk. So here's the raid in Canada.
Last night I got a call from our employees roughly around 6:30, 6 o'clock-ish, saying that the Regina Police Service was here confiscating people's medication. It's obviously a big hit to the business, and that's what they want to do. They want to shut us down so we can't start up and that we can't help people. And I would question their motives if for shutting down a dispensary that's helping people with prescriptions. I would suspect they should maybe reevaluate that.
Who in this room is surprised that this happened? I want to see a show of hands. If someone is surprised, I said this before, I cannot think of a time in my career where we have given what I call fair warning. I understand that there's a possibility, there's legalization coming forward, and that's going to open up some opportunities in our city, but there's going to be a structure. There are people that say, well, I rely on that medicinal marijuana, and I know that. I know the value that medicinal marijuana has for people who have a prescription. But there is a process in place to get that. I didn't set that process up. I don't enforce that process, but it exists. No, this is not a waste of resources. This is what the community expects from police. We are still going to have a role to play once legalization happens. This is an evolving role that we will play in the community, and our role is to keep our community safe. We've seized a lot of evidence, a lot. Truckloads of evidence. So we're going to go through the evidence. We will, from that, we'll make a determination as to who is involved in knowingly selling, trafficking drugs in our community.
The plan is to keep on helping patients. We have thousands of patients across the province. We get a lot of support from patients that tell us their life story and tell us how much we help their life, and it's touching. And when you see that every day, you can't just desert those people. That itself would be criminal. So we got to keep on keeping and making sure that we're helping the patients at the end of the day.
Okay, and let's hope that that dispensary can keep helping their patients, and let's watch what happens in Canada. It's a mirror, and we have to watch what's happening in other states and what's in other countries, and we have to learn by those mistakes. We'll be right back with Dr. Jeff Chen from a TED Talk. He's a UCLA researcher, right after this.
It's all about the 420 MMJ Radio. The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana.
Okay, and we're back. And in 1983, when I was 33 years old, I suffered a very minor heart attack. I lost a little branch on one side of my heart. And it was minor. People, you know, when I walked into the ER, they thought I had heartburn or something. But this was at UCLA. I lived right near UCLA in Westwood, LA, California. And after I got out of rehab and went through all kinds of stuff, you know, I started smoking cannabis again. This is my 50th year smoking cannabis. Started in the summer of 1968, and even back then in the 80s, there were some doctors that were doing some studies and researching cannabis at UCLA, and I had actually called them up and told them I was a heart patient, and told them that I thought that I was getting some real benefits from using cannabis, post heart attack. Of course, now we know this is, you know, like 40 years ago. And now, you know, it's starting to come out that it does have some benefits. But there's still ongoing research at UCLA. And I found this TED Talk the other night with a Dr. Jeff Chen. And I pulled two little clips from it that I thought would be interesting for everybody to listen to. So here's Dr. Jeff Chen in the first clip from UCLA. And this is a TED Talk.
Here's a quote I want to show you. Targeting endocannabinoid system activity may have therapeutic potential in nearly all diseases affecting humans. All diseases affecting humans. And this is not fringe science. This is actually coming out of our government's own National Institutes of Health, who've been doing research into the endocannabinoid system for over a decade. So on one hand, we have the endocannabinoid system. And if we can manipulate the system properly, we could theoretically affect all diseases affecting mankind. On the other hand, we have cannabis and cannabinoids, of which there's only a few scientifically accepted medical uses. That includes the use of cannabis for nausea, for anorexia, which is when you're not gaining enough weight, muscle spasms, when you have painful, involuntary muscle contractions, and lastly, chronic pain. So there's a disconnect here. And part of that disconnect is because cannabis is a Schedule I drug. It's been incredibly difficult to do research on it for almost a century. But I'm hopeful. And in my future, I see that there's a coming wave of a cannabis scientific renaissance. And one of the molecules that I'm particularly excited about is CBD. So here's another quote. Let me walk you through this. So CBD, this is that non-psychoactive chemical in cannabis. It can be useful for seizures. It could be useful as an antioxidant, like resveratrol that we find in wine. It's a neuroprotectant that can be used in neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's or Parkinson's. It's an anti-inflammatory that can be used in autoimmune disorders like lupus or Crohn's disease. It's an analgesic that can be used in pain. It has anti-tumor properties, that is, it directly kills cancer cells. It has antipsychotic properties that could be used in schizophrenics. and it could also be used in anxiety. Now, we have to take all of this with a grain of salt. This is all very preliminary research. It's only been done in animals, so we don't know if it'll pan out in humans. But contrast this with the seemingly miraculous anecdotal data we hear from people who use cannabis. We have to take all of that anecdotal data with a grain of salt as well. And that's because of something called the placebo effect. And the placebo effect is when your positive expectations about a treatment actually make that treatment seem more effective than it actually is. So for example, this is if you have back pain and I give you a sugar pill and I tell you this will help your back pain and you take it and you go, whoa, it does actually help my back pain. That's the placebo effect in action. And in fact, for cannabis, the placebo effect is even stronger than that for other compounds. And that's for a few reasons. So people who are using cannabis, they're often using it for subjective things, things like pain or mood. And whenever you have subjective outcomes in a patient, the placebo effect is going to be heightened. Moreover, cannabis is psychoactive. So when you give someone cannabis, they feel different, and they feel it immediately. And because they feel different, they think the cannabis is working, and that's going to increase the placebo effect even more. And lastly, cannabis has this miraculous reputation. So going in, you have this immense expectation that it's going to benefit you, and so you are actually going to feel like it did benefit you.
And in this next little clip from the TED Talk, this is again Dr. Jeff Chen from UCLA, he calls this, that cannabis is most likely a gateway herb.
Now, on the issue of cannabis being a gateway drug, this is the hypothesis that although cannabis might not be very dangerous, it leads people to use other drugs that are indeed harmful and dangerous. And for the most part, this gateway theory has been debunked. But I think cannabis is a different type of gateway. I think it's a gateway herb. And you see, the market size of cannabis in America is 100 times larger than the size of that of echinacea, or ginkgo biloba, or turmeric. And so I say cannabis is a gateway herb that is going to precipitate a revolution in how we look at the compounds in food and plants as medicine and as part of our health and wellness. So at the end of the day, is cannabis a panacea, a placebo, or a poison? Well, it appears that it's all of these things. It just depends on who you are, what condition you're using it for, which cannabinoid you're using, and at which dosage. And the only way to really tease this apart is to do good scientific research. But like we mentioned earlier, it's incredibly difficult. Cannabis is a Schedule I drug. It's arguably the single hardest substance to study in our country. Moreover, traditional sources of funding aren't available for cannabis research. The government will not fund cannabis research. So what can we do? Well, if this is an area you're passionate about, as citizens, we have to fund the research ourselves, and that's through micro donations so that we can crowdfund cannabis research and finally start teasing this apart. And only through good scientific research can we start to unravel the mysteries of this gateway herb and usher in a revolution in how we look for medically useful compounds in food and in plants. Thank you.
We'll be right back after this.
One pill makes you larger.
Well, thank you all for listening to this holiday edition for Easter and Passover, a clip show of some interesting news from all around the globe. Next week, I hope to have another great interview for you. Also, I'd like to thank my two radio mentors, both with the initials HS. Thank you for your inspiration. If you'd like to be a guest on the show, if you are a patient with a story, if you are an advocate, you have a website, a product to sell, and a story to tell, it's info@mmjradio.com. Again, info@mmjradio.com. If you'd like to listen to our old shows, you can go to medicalmarijuanaradio.com. You can also go to 663-0507.com. That points right to our Medical Marijuana Radio. Also, my YouTube channel is LSLove88. On SoundCloud, we're MMJ Radio. On Spreaker and Cannabis, Spreaker, we're also MMJ Radio. CannabisTube.net, we have a channel if you want to watch the video. Also on Spreaker and iHeartRadio, the Time for Hemp Global Broadcasting Network, and on Now TV, channel 937, and thecannachannel.com coming very soon.
Shalom.
Oh, yeah, no. Fuck the Cheeto.
Papu Puyita, Suyita, Papu Dini, Sapapu Papu.